My name is Abir Zayad. I'm archeologist from Jerusalem. First, welcome inside the Al-Aqsa Mosque. It's very important to understand that the Al-Aqsa Mosque is the whole area. It's not only one building. It's not the Dome of the Rock. It's not the Qibli. The Dome of the Rock and the Qibli are just part from Al-Aqsa Mosque. Buildings are important from historical point of view, but from religion point of view, what is important for us is the area itself. So, we are in a place that we call it Old Aqsa. This place was entrance to the mosque. Two entrances, one that side and one here. Even you can see part from the entrance, you can see the column here, and you can see where the gate is open in both sides. And you can see also the domes which we be on the entrance. So people, especially who was living outside from this side, which is the palaces for Bani Umayyah, was coming from these gates to inside the mosque. So in the period of Salah al-Din, he closed all the gates like this, from south and from east side, all the gates closed by Salah al-Din. So this one, he closed it completely. That one, instead of closing it completely, he add a building. And that building was a zawiya. A zawiya is a building for Sufi. So he add a zawiya, a building for Sufi here, which we call it zawiya al-Khatni. So today is a served as a library. Also here we have a very beautiful thing that we need to speak about it. First, we start with the well there, which people call it oil well. People think that this is a place where reserving for oil for the mosque. But from the plaster that had been used inside, we know that it's not suitable for reserving water, for reserving oil. It is suitable for reserving water. The other thing is about these beautiful pillars and beautiful stones that is very, very huge, as you see, like what you see also in the Ibrahimi Mosque. It's very similar. The reason why this is very similar to the Ibrahimi Mosque, that the same person who built the Ibrahimi Mosque, he is the same person that built here, which is in Roman period, before 2,000 years ago. His name is Herod. That Herod himself is Palestinian. He's from Adonian tribe. We will go now to the main building, which is Qibli. Al Qibli building. This building is different than the Dome of the Rock. This building is like a timeline for the history of Al-Aqsa Mosque. The Dome of the Rock is like you are traveling in time machine to go back to the early Islamic period. Here, no, it's like a timeline that you are walking with the time here. The first one to build in this area, it was Umar bin Khattab, 636. The building that he built, it was from wood. It was enough for 3,000 persons. Of course, we have a description for that through some of travelers who came to Jerusalem in that period. The building was in this area of the mosque because it's the closest area to the Qibla. This building was not a big building, to say, or not fantasy building, beautiful building, suitable for a Jerusalem city, which is a city very important for a Christian, and there was a lot of beautiful churches. So when Bani Umayyah become the leader, Bani Umayyah start thinking, especially Abdul Malik bin Marwan, that why we do not have a building for us, like the Christian in Jerusalem? Why we do not have a beautiful building? So he decided to build, to make a renovation for the whole complex. So he start with the Dome of the Rock. And he built the Dome of the Rock and fixed the basement to build a huge building here. But he died before he was able to do that. So his son, Sulaiman bin Abdul Malik, he was able to build the building here. The building that he done, it was twice bigger than this size. Now it's seven sections. We call it in Arabic Ruwaq. In that period it was 14. All right. So double size of this one. The remains from that period, it's few. One of the remains that you can see it is inside this pillar. Because of the earthquake, one of the stone was going down. So you are able to see inside this pillar the old columns from Bani Umayyah period. So when we go, when we start walking, we will go to see that one. Of course, as I said, that because we are in the land that you have a lot of earthquake. So in Abbasid period also, this mosque was destroyed with the earthquake. So also the Abbasid rebuilt the building. So these reddish columns are from Abbasid period. After the Abbasid, it was the Fatimi period. The Fatimi period, we have an earthquake. The Khalifa in that period refused to rebuild the mosque again. So the mosque, his name is Al-Hakim bi-Amrillah. The mosque stayed while destroyed. Till his son came. When his son came, he take out the gold from the gate of the Dome of the Rock and he used it to rebuild the mosque. But because he did not have enough money, he make it half size of the original one. So the building that you see today and the dome is going back to Fatimi period. After the Fatimi, it was the Crusaders. The Fatimi left us, the army go, did not fight, and left us to the Crusaders. When the Crusaders entered to Jerusalem, 1099, in their books they write that they killed in that day in Jerusalem 70,000 persons in Jerusalem. In our book, 40,000 persons was killed in that day. So after that, of course, they controlled Al-Aqsa Mosque. So what did they join with this building? They cut it to rooms and they use it for what they call it the night temple as a place for them to sleep. So what is remained from that period? First, these pillars are going back to the Crusader period. Salah al-Din, of course, take most of the things that they done it. But one thing he left it, which no one of us know why, it's the chapel. So you can see the chapel that was left by Salah al-Din, which we call it today, Mihrab Zakaria. But it's a chapel built by the Crusader. Why he left it? No one have the answer. Maybe because the rosette is beautiful, we don't know. Also, Salah al-Din, in his period, he done, and with his nephew, they done few things in this building. His nephew, he had the entrance that we enter from it today, outside entrance. This was added by his nephew. By Salah al-Din, as we said, that he take the things out and he make the mihrab. It's the only original place in all the mosque that you find the name of Salah al-Din from his period. Do you know what the name of Salah al-Din? It's Yusuf. His name is Yusuf bin Ayyub. So you will read that with the nickname on the mihrab when we go there. After Salah al-Din period is the Mamluk period. The main thing that you can see from the Mamluk period is the decoration for the dome, and you can even read the name of the Mamluk who do that. You can read, it's just in front of us here. It's written Mawlana Sultan Al-Malik Al-Nasir Al-Alam Al-Adil Al-Mujahid Al-Murabit. So it's a lot of titles. And underneath it, you can read the other Sultan who make renovation, which is in Ottoman period. You can read the Sultan Ibn Sultan Al Khan Mahmud Khan Ibn Sultan Mahmud Thani. Sorry, Abdul Hamid Thani. So you can read the names of them, which tell you that they had done things. So this dome, Mamluk and Ottoman. Also from the Ottoman period, you can see the name of the Sahaba around you, all the Sahaba al-Mubashirin bil Jannah, and in at the gate you can read al-Hasan and al-Hussein. So now we will start walking and give more explanation If you have any question, please ask it while we are walking. Okay? So we'll go first to see the column which go back to the Umayyad period. So who see it can come with me. Who was not able to see the name of the Mamluk Sultan, it's exactly here in this section, Malik al-Nasir. And in this section, you can read the name of Mahmud Khan ibn Sultan Abdul Hamid al-Thani in this section here. And the name of Qalawun al-Salihi, you can read it in this section. And for the mihrab, if you look to the second line, who can read Arabic language, he can read it. Ala al-taqwa, mu'assis Abdullah wa waliyuh, Yusuf bin Ayyub, Abu al-Muzaffar, al-Malik al-Nasir, Salah al-Dunya wa al-Din. So it's the only original place from his period you will find his name. You will find his name in other places, but not from his period. This one is from his period. And also when Salah al-Din came, he bring with him minbar. The minbar that he bring it is exactly like this one. What is interesting about this building, of course we call it Mosque of Umar. What is interesting about this building is the mihrab. Why it's interesting? It's the only mihrab in a mosque that you find it with the animals. You can see the animals here, even this side you can see the head of the animal. But maybe because it's not a real animal, it's just an imagination animal, it was accepted. But of course they did not do it, they just reuse it from the Crusader period. The marble is very expensive, we don't have enough marble, so they reuse it. And they did not have a problem with that. So it's something unique, you will not be able to find it, I think, in any other place, in any mosque. Also from the window, you are able to see two things. You are able to see the palaces that are going back to Umayyad period in the time of Sulaiman bin Abd al-Malik, around 700 AD. He built palaces here. We have seven palaces go to that period. Even Damascus, which considered the capital of Bani Umayyah, they did not have seven palaces. One of the palaces have, in the, of course, it's not exist now, but we, from archaeological remains, we know that it was have a gate enter directly to inside the mosque. So you can imagine who are the person that have the right to enter from his bedroom immediately to the mihrab. For me, I think maybe it's the Khalifa who have this access. Also from here, you are able to see Silwan village. Silwan village is considered the hugest area in the in Jerusalem that Palestinians are living. Only 20% of us as Palestinians living in Jerusalem. We are living in this area, which is used to be part from the old city during the history. This area is where Jerusalem established as a village before 10,000 years ago and as a city before 5,000 years ago. So Jerusalem is very, very old city and a village, but it starts in Silwan and growing up little by little in this direction. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. غلبت الروم في أدنى الأرض وهم من بعد غلبهم سيغلبون في بضع سنين. This surah is speaking about the Persian when they went the war against the Rome, 614. Why I say it here? Because this surah have two miracles. The first miracle is to say that the Rome lost the war in the lowest point of the earth. And no one know in that period that the lowest point of the earth is Palestine. The second thing, that the Roman, from a military way, they can't win the war in a few years. But the Quran tell us that they will win the war in a few years. And they won it with a trick after 7 years. What's the connection with this surah, with these two miracles, with the mosque? That when the Sasanian or the Persian entered to Palestine, they destroyed all the churches, all the nativity they did not destroy. The rest of the churches in all Palestine, they destroyed. So also in Jerusalem, they destroyed all churches. So when the Rome win the war again and they control the country again, They collect all the collapse that they have it in Jerusalem, and they throw it in the only place that they're not using, which is Al-Aqsa Mosque. So when the Muslims came, they used part from this in the building, and the rest of it you can see here. We are in a mosque, we call it Buraq Mosque. Of course, there is a renovation for this place in Mamluk, Ottoman period, or other period, but to go to the oldest thing that we have here, and also for the hadith. If you can look here, this gate, we call it the Prophet Gate, which is closed now. This gate, this wall, was exist in the period when our Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam had arrived to Jerusalem in the Isra wal Mi'raj. So, what we have about touching the Buraq in the hadith? We have in fact two hadith sahih. One is say that when our Prophet arrived, Jibreel used his finger to open a place for him to tie his Buraq. And the second hadith is say that our Prophet had tied the Buraq in the same ring which other Prophets had tied their Buraqs. If it's, this is the original ring or not, I can't say, I don't know. But if this wall was in his period, yes. That he could be tied his Buraq in this wall, yes. At the end, most of our ulama agree on this wall that Al Buraq wall. Okay, so this is Al Marwani Mosque. We call it Al Marwani because the one who make the roof, fixed the place, was Abdul Malik bin Marwan. In his planning for building the whole complex. Of course, some of the stones are used and some of the foundation are old, going back to Roman period. And it's very easy, you can know this from the size of the stones, you can see this from the way of the stones itself cutting, you know which from which period. During the Crusader period, the Crusader used the place as a stable for horses. And they call it Suleiman's Table. And this is why you will see some of these, like behind here, some of them have a place where to tie the animal down, to see it like this one. Another thing about the place here, that we have here a mihrab in the top here. That mihrab have a lot of stories. So I will tell you the whole stories, I will tell you what we know from archaeology, and it's up to you what you want to believe. So this mihrab, some people say that here was Maryam alayhi salam. Some people say that Isa was born here. Some people say that the stone that Isa was born in Beit Lahem, that the nephew of Salah al-Din bring it here to this place. All of this, we do not have any archaeology or historical base to know. What really know, that this mihrab was built by the nephew of Salah al-Din, Mu'adhim Isa, his name is Isa, and that the Ottoman add the dome on top of it. So if it was the real mihrab where Maryam alayhi salam was sitting or not, we don't know. We know, of course, that Maryam alayhi salam was in Al-Aqsa Mosque. Which spot, we don't know. Of course, you can go up and look from the door to that mihrab and to that dome. For this building, I will give you just explanation about the numbers first to try to understand it. It's an octagon building. وَيَحْمِلُ عَرْشَ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ ثَمَانٍ. 8 angels holding the chair of the God. 4 gates, 4 seasons. 12 pillars, 12 months. The number of the window is the number of the week of the year. And after that, the Ottoman had 2 windows. When you enter from any gate, you will see 5 columns. We praise 5 times a day. And the foundation of Islam is 5.
So these number just to make you understand, to get more to understand this building. The mosaic, we have 1 kilometer square of mosaic. The mosaic is very interesting here, and you can see the colors, how they use it, that each arches are different than the other, each decoration between the arches are different. And you have element from Sasanian art, from Arabic art, from Byzantine art mixed together for the first time to start a new art, which is the Islamic art. It's very simple, it's exactly like the Muslims. They used to be a different nation, Arab, Sasanian, Byzantine, all of them, and now they become one nation with the Islam. It's very symbolic, the mosaic is telling that for you from art. Also, it will give you the history about how the way of writing had been changed. For example, if you look to the writing here, up there is a green line and the writing is in gold. There. Not in this arch, there. Okay, you can see Allah wahdahu la sharika lahu, lahul mulk wa lahul hamd, yuhyi wa yumit wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. You can read it here. But the first thing that you're supposed to notice, there's no dots. At all, there's no dots. You can see this. But if you look little here, of course, this is from Bani Umayya period. If you look little here, you will see some of the word had dots. وَمَنْ يَكْفُرُ بِآيَاتِ اللَّهِ have dots. This is when the Abbasid make reconstruction, they add dots for it. So if you try to compare this way of writing with here, it's completely different. The way of the writing, the dots, the signs, it's completely different. Why? This is first Surah Taha, you can read it. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You can read it here. So this one is addition. When the Crusader came to Jerusalem, we see what they done to the Qibli, we see what they done to Marwani. What they done here, they make it a church. So they put part from the Bible here. So when Salah al-Din came, he take it out and he put this Quran here. So now, how we know that Salah al-Din put it? By two things. First, the books from his period saying that. Second, that Al-Malik al-Nasir again, the Mamluk, when he make renovation, you can read his name in this section here, Al-Malik al-Nasir, when he make renovation, he write that he make it after Salah al-Din. So if you look here in this section, you can see Salah al-Din Yusuf bin Ayyub taghammadahullah. Taghammadahullah means that he died. So you can read also the name of Salah al-Din here, but not from his original period. The first one to think about putting a defense around the rock, it was the Crusader. And the original defense is still inside the museum till today. The roof that we have, the wooden roof, are from Ottoman period. This beautiful dome that you see it, it's not the same dome that you see it from outside. There is 1 meter the distance between the dome that you see it from here and the dome that you see it from outside. The rock here is a natural rock. It's the highest point of the mountain, and the cave inside it is a natural cave. It's not floating, it's not flying, nothing like this is in religion. Most of ulama agree on this spot for our Prophet Mi'raj. Of course, in the religion itself, from Al-Aqsa Mosque does not giving which spot exactly, but because this is the highest point, they agree on it. There is an opening in the middle of the cave. Some people say it's done by the finger of Jibril, but the only thing that Jibril do it with his finger in Hadith is to clean up or to open the place where our Prophet tied his Buraq. So there is nothing in Hadith to speak about this. And if you look at it, you can see that it's done by a human being. This stone with the Ottoman at this dome. And they add inside this box, they bring a tube with one hair They say that it's the hair of the Prophet, and they put it here inside, and it's closed. Normally, no one see it. It's closed on it all the time. We have many tombs in this side of the mosque that they have a window inside the mosque. So in fact, they are not inside the mosque. There is no tomb at all inside the mosque. Even some, for example, in where we call it the chair of Suleiman, you will see something like a tomb. It's not a tomb. There is nobody inside it. And the place is called chair of Suleiman because Suleiman bin Abdul Malik had taken the bay'ah there, not because of the Prophet of Suleiman, alayhi salam. So this place here, we have more than one tomb. But what I want you to see is the first one from this tomb was buried. His name is Muhammad Ali al-Hindi. Do you know this person? He immigrated from India to UK. And during the British occupation to Palestine, he worked very hard for Jerusalem and for Palestine. So when he died in UK, his family wanted to send his body back to India to be buried in his village. But our Mufti sent to him, to his family, and say that this person, his heart in Jerusalem, and he's supposed to buried in Jerusalem. So his body was sent to here from UK, and he was buried here. So his tomb is in the middle here. He's the only one that are not from Jerusalem and buried here. The other here, you can see Musa Qadim al-Husseini, Abdul Qadir al-Husseini, Faisal al-Husseini, Abdul Hamid Shumar. All of these people are from Jerusalem, and they are important people. But for us, the most important two people from these is Abdul Qadir al-Husseini and Faisal al-Husseini. Abdul Qadir al-Husseini was our leader in the war in 1948.